truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Holy and healing God,
we confess that we are bound to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you on thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you. For his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows upon them the Holy Spirit. Our gathering hymn this morning is broken, is in the insert of the Lord.
Thank you. Belton.
And with you.
Please be with Bob.
The Lord be with you.
To read the little paragraph that precedes the lesson. Wisdom is portrayed as a woman who invites people to partake of her banquet. Just as ordinary food is necessary for physical life, wisdom's food, insight and understanding, is necessary for fullness of life with God. Partaking of wisdom's banquet is the way to life. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her animals. She has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her servant girls. She calls from the highest places in the town. You that are simple, turn in here. To those without sense, she says, come, eat of my bread and drink of the wine I have mixed. Lay aside immaturity and live and walk in the way of insight. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read Psalm 34 responsibly. Fear the Lord, you that are his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing.
The young lions lack and shall have hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack nothing as true.
Come, children, and listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord.
Who among you loves life and desires long life to which yours I heard?
Keep your tongue from evil speaking and your lips from lying words.
Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it.
The second reading is from the fifth chapter of Ephesians. True wisdom integrates our new reality in Christ with our Christian fellowship and daily conduct. Because we are filled with the Spirit, Christians regularly rejoice together, give thanks to God for one another, and care for one another. In this way, we revere our Lord Jesus Christ. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for this is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. Word of God, word of life, this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Project if I have to, so y'all can hear me with it or without it.
Y'all hear me in the back?
That's good.
Okay. Now, when I was trying to figure out where the Lord wanted me to share today, He took me over to 1 Timothy. If you got a Bible, I don't see a lot of Bibles in this church. I got Bibles? 1 Timothy 1, verse 12. And it's something we've talked about a little bit, or at least I've talked about a little bit when I've shared it. 1 Timothy 1, 12. Before I go there, let's pray. Lord, help us at this time to receive your word the way that you would have it implanted in our hearts. Fill us with your spirit, renew us. If we have any sin, forgive us, Lord. Wash us with the cleansing work of your word. Make us like we were the day you saved us. And then, Lord, speak to us in such a way that we grow and become more like Jesus through what we say and do as we learn today. Help us all to learn. We need you. And we claim the blood of the Lord Jesus over this time. Ask that you would rebuke and bind Satan. Deliver us from anything that he would seek to do at this time. And have your way here as we seek to glorify you and to edify the church. In Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Timothy 1:12. I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has strengthened me because he considered me faithful, putting me into service. Now, Paul is talking to Timothy. He's a new preacher. He's a young man. He's reminding him where Paul got his direction, where everyone in the church gets direction from. It has to be the Holy Spirit. When we read the Word, God speaks to us. When we pray, we speak to Him, right? Y'all understand that? If you don't read the Bible, you're not going to learn anything from God. I can stand up here and teach every Sunday and on Wednesdays too, but that's all you're going to get out of it. God wants to take you by the hand and lead you through and build you and make you what He created you to be. All of us have a purpose. All of us can't sing. I, for one, cannot sing, but I can make a joyful noise. So what does it mean to be put in the ministry? Scripture is so specific. And let me give you one example out in this one place in Timothy. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord. And I'm going to have to share a little bit of Greek background. So don't everybody eyes roll back in your head. Just listen for a second. It's a present active indicative. Is there any English teachers in here? No? In order to learn Greek, you've got to be good at English. And where I come from, they use words like weren't, it weren't me, I ain't heard nothing. Those sort of things have made it tough to learn. But present active indicative, first person. That means when you read that, if you look at it in the Greek, it specifically refers to who's reading it. So it's like, it means for me, today, right now. This is God's point for me. First, present active indicative, right now, it's happening today. First person singular, that puts it on the object, the person who's reading it. It's a continuous action from now and forever. It's a present action. All believers are in the ministry. How many people are in here are disciples?
We all are.
But we all are. I've heard that, right?
We all are.
Sometimes I've asked that question, people look around and go, yes. If you're a disciple, that means you are a learner. You're someone that God has put in the field. Why did he save you? Just to sit in church? No, we've got a purpose, and it's glorious. You know, we read in the book of Acts, we look at what Paul has done, we see, you know, the works of the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit is working in your life, there's miracles taking place. If you got up today, a miracle took place, right? There's people all over this country and around the world that are scared to death right now because of COVID. Don't misunderstand what I say. I'm not afraid of it. Because greater is he that's in me than he or what's in the world. I believe in the sovereignty of God. There's nothing can happen in the life of a Christian that God does not either allow or ordain. That's the two aspects of God's will. He either causes it or he allows it. Now, if I want to get drunk, he's not necessarily going to stop me from doing that. I can run amok, but what happens if you drink day after day after day after day? It destroys your body. If I want to do drugs, day after day after day after day, it destroys your body. It eats your brain up. If I want to eat incessantly and never stop, again, sin comes with its own punishment. It's been ordained that way. And I'm not attacking anybody. I just want you to understand that God's got a purpose for your life. You're a disciple. Today, when you read the word, it's for you. For you and for me. God loves you. He wants to talk to you. He wants to be close to you. He wants to guide you. He strengthened me or he enabled me. It means both when he put me in the ministry. It's not just about people who stand up and preach. I've mentioned this a couple of times. Everybody in the church is given a gift or gifts. You have supernatural abilities. You know, when I first got saved, the last thing I ever saw myself doing was trying to tell somebody else what to do. And in me, you don't want to hear my opinion. You want to hear what's in the Word. Because what I think has nothing to do with it, really. The Word speaks for itself. And as it says in Hebrews chapter 4:12, the Word of God is alive and living. All right, I'll move on. Putting me into service, that word for service is diakonos. We're reading the word deacons. You know how deacons were first used in the church, teaches in the book of Acts? There were people who served tables. There were people sitting around at different places, and they were helping meet the needs of those in the church, with different offices. All Christians are in this mold for service, period. If you're a disciple, you're here to serve. It doesn't mean you won't make mistakes. None of us are perfect. We all do. I only point at me when I say this. We all do stupid things. And sometimes I sit and wonder in the morning, what am I going to do stupid today? Because something always comes up. And let me tell you, when you think you've risen above that, you're in for it. It's like when you think you have mastered some sin, you don't have to worry about it anymore. Look out. It's going to hit you right between the eyes. And what does it mean to be in service? I'm going to drag this out just a little bit. It means you're an intermediary, right? You're a go-between. And we'll look at 2 Corinthians in just a minute, and it breaks it out. 2 Corinthians 5, if you've got your Bible, 2 Corinthians 5, starting about verse 17. I just love that verse. If y'all listen to me preach for very long, you'll probably learn it pretty quickly because I use it all the time. Verse 17 through 21. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, what does it mean to be in Christ? That means Jesus talked about it when he spoke to Nicodemus. Except a man be born again, he shall not see the kingdom of heaven. What did Nicodemus say when I got to enter my mother's womb and be born again? He said, no, you're born of the flesh. Where he talks about being born of water, you must be born of the Spirit. You're born into your human family, you got to be born in the family of God. Simple as that. Nothing complicated. God, the Lord lays it right out. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature or a new creation. What does that mean? What does it mean to be a new creation? That's where discipleship comes in. The Lord is the one who empowers you to serve him. Where is it? Philippians 2:13, I believe it is. God gives you the desire and the ability to do God's will. That's the definition of grace. He gives it to you. don't know what to do. Well, ask him. If he is alive and living, don't you think he can communicate with you? He created you to communicate with. He didn't just cast us out here and say, go do the best you can. No. He empowers us. He wants to see results through us. And let's not get confused. Works will not get you into heaven. If you go to church every day of your life, you give everything you make to the poor, if you do everything you can to help other people, and you're depending on the things that you've done to get you into heaven, you're going to be very sad on the day you die. There's a lot of good people in hell. It's full of good people. Only Christ will get you into heaven. He said, John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. Now, that doesn't exclude good works, because James talks about, show me your faith without works, and I'll show you my faith by works. In other words, if you have Christ, if you're this new creation, you will do those things. Not because you have to do it to get into heaven, because you love the Lord. Simple as that. And he loves you. Of all the people in the world, today, if you're sitting here and you know Christ, you are the most blessed on the face of the earth. There's countries where they don't know who he is. I've been reading lately so many places in the Middle East that people are waking up in the middle of the night and Christ is standing at the foot of the bed. Have you been reading about this stuff? In Muslim countries, where because people can't get there, the Lord himself is appearing to people. People are getting saved. You know, we hear all this stuff about Iran, Iraq, China. There's 10 to 25,000 people come to Christ in China every day. Every day. There's Christians before they took hostages back in the 80s. I had friends who were Iranians who were here studying. Some of the finest Christians I ever met. They were crying when they had to go back to Iran. They were all called back. We have brothers and sisters there. When you listen to the news in the evenings, remember, their point of view is not always right. Do investigations. Pray for those people. And I don't want to get too far out chasing things, but remember Haiti today. Those people are suffering. They're still uncovering people as we speak. They don't have water, they don't have food, and they've got a hurricane coming. I've listened to some scientists that I follow regularly. They're talking about a big earthquake in South America, in Peru, and Peru and Chile, somewhere right in there. Something about the Nazca Plate, there's so much pressure built up. We're getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Bigger earthquakes. That's one of the signs of the end times, y'all know. I mean, there was, 186 earthquakes yesterday. But anyway, let me go back to what I'm supposed to be teaching. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creature, the old things have passed away. Behold! You know, when I see that word in Scripture, I want to jump back and go, behold! That's what it's all about. You are the behold in Christ. Whoa, step up and pay attention. These are the people of God. Separate you from everybody else in the world. You are not fully human, complete, until you know Christ. I'm going to fight chasing some rabbits in a minute. Because there's things I just want to teach. Behold, new things have come. The new things for me, just like for you, is suddenly wanting to serve God. You know, before I accepted Christ, I didn't want to serve God. Remember, I remember seeing people with those stickers on their car, God is my co-pilot, or something like that. I remember thinking, well, I think God should do that. I had Harley wings on whatever I owned, you know. Harlan was my God at that time. But I understand that Harlan ain't going to get me into heaven. Being good won't get me into heaven. Only Jesus will get me there. Verse 18, 2 Corinthians 5, now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ. What does it mean to be reconciled? Another word? To be reconciled. I'd say, my wife and I have an argument, which we like to do on a regular basis. To be reconciled means to make peace between us. To make peace, we come back together. And gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That's you and me. Who are we reconciled? The rest of the world. I can't reconcile with the Holy Spirit working through me. The words have power. There's something here that's supernatural. What does supernatural mean? Beyond the natural. And let me just touch on this so that it helps me understand it. Maybe it will give us another rabbit trail. In the book of Genesis, Adam and Eve, when Eve is standing there talking to the serpent, and she says, well, the Lord told me if I eat that, I'll die. What did the serpent say? Did he tell you you would die? You won't die. Right? When she took a bite of that apple, humanity didn't die until Adam did, because he was the representative from God. But he didn't fall down dead, did he? But he died spiritually. And what happens right after that? God comes walking in the cool of the evening. He comes down to see Adam and spend time with Eve. And they're hiding in a bush with leaves over their private parts. He said, what are you doing hiding? He said, well, we're naked. He said, who told you you were naked? That's the knowledge they got from eating the fruit. That's the knowledge that separates us from God. That's why when you come here to be made with, be made right with God and be in a better position than they ever, ever understood and knew, is to have Christ, who died in your place, took your sin, when you accept him and believe that he did it for you, and brings you into the family. You have something they didn't have. Nobody can take that away from you. God saved you. That's what he's talking about. A new man or woman or child in Christ. Y'all hear me? Everybody hear me? The ministry of reconciliation, verse 19, namely that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Why is he not counting their trespasses against them? Because everybody knows John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. You know 3:18? I'll read it. He who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged already. You understand? Born into judgments. The only way out of it is to be reconciled to God. The only way to have new life, to be a new creature or creation in Christ, is to believe and ask him into your heart. And let me tell you, being a Christian doesn't mean giving up the 10 coolest things you like to do and doing the 10 things you least like doing. He gives you a whole new perspective. He gives you that desire and the ability. He draws you out. The man in heaven who's sitting at the right hand of God, there is a human being on the throne in heaven. You know that. Jesus, fully man and fully God. Fully man. You know what they say the only man-made thing in heaven is? The holes in his hands. And his side. That's the only man-made thing in heaven. Now, when When I go to heaven, I want my family following me when I go. Right? So your first ministry is to your family. And then God opens that door, whoops, and spreads you into the world. And as you're obedient in that circle that he puts you in, well, he expands that. And your ministry moves out and out and out. It's as big as you are faithful. Verse 19, namely, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting the trespasses against them, and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. That's us to tell them, God loves you. Repent, believe. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were entreating through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. We beg you. He's pleading with people. Amen. Think about it. He served the King of the universe. The one who simply spoke and things came into being. The one who, before he created the heavens and the earth, space, time, matter, light, before he did any of that, he looked down through time and he saw everybody here. There's nothing hidden from God. He knows the past, the present, and the future. He exists within time, but he also exists without time. Remember, time is an encapsulated place where we fit. Eternity is outside of time. So when we leave this place and go into eternity, we may all get there at the same time. Who knows? It doesn't matter if this time is not important. But everybody looking at me today is going. You get to choose where you spend eternity. That's a powerful thought. I have too many friends who are in hell. And I have seen people that God got a hold of. You know, it says in 1 John, there is a sin unto death. I had a buddy. I don't think I've told this story. I can't remember. I've shared this thing so many times in so many places. He was a young Christian. And I remember seeing him. He was out with the Bible before I became Christian. Following, trying to do what the Lord wanted. And my brother-in-law sold his Harley and the kid bought it. I told y'all this story. No. And before I knew it, he was wearing a cutoff jacket and he had a rocker on the back. It said Prospect. He was with the Banditos. And I went to him and I tried to talk to him because I didn't think he knew what he was getting into. I mean, I've been around bikers all my life. It's not a happy place. I mean, they have a brotherhood they call where they defend themselves, but I don't get too far into that. But he didn't know, so I went to him and I tried to witness to him about it. I shared with him. He just shook his head. I was like 32 or 33. He was about 22. His brothers were my best friends. I knew his family for a long time. Well, he didn't listen. I went again. The third time I went, he just stopped. He said, Bobby, I ain't got time for Jesus in my life right now. Whoa, man, that scared me when I heard it. I feel like I've been stabbed because that's not a thing to think or to say. Not if you belong to him. 3 months he was dead. He was riding with some guys. There were three of them. There was an accident of some kind. First two went around it. He was grinding something. Got a piece of metal in his eye. Was only seen out of one eye. And he hit something, fell down the road, and died right there. And I remember thinking, man, the Lord just spoke to me so plain. I had a friend named Bobby Joe. When I first got saved, I started witnessing all my friends. They'd come over. They'd come to my trailer. Everybody bring beer in because they didn't know anything changing my life. I'd bring it home here. I figured I had a captive audience. I could tell them what was going on. I thought they'd want to know. And Bobby Joe is my best friend. And he's a guy, he liked to fight with a knife. You know, he liked to go out and drink and get knife fights and stuff.
He was crazy, fortunately. He was afraid of me. But he listened to me when I shared, and he wouldn't hear it. He just wouldn't listen. He went off with his sister. His brother was a bandito. They went up into Colorado. I had talked to him the day before. And he told somebody, oh, Bobby, you know, I'm tired of hearing this stuff. God bless you. And he went in. His sister and her husband drove him to the front door of a drugstore. He went in, held the place up, and was getting narcotics and other stuff. And as he was coming out the door into the parking lot, the druggist stepped out with a pistol, shot him in the back, and killed him. Knocked him out in the parking lot. His sister was there. She was in a car waiting with her husband. They just drove away. They said, well, I never do anything like that. It doesn't matter. What you would do is either be obedient as a disciple or not. Trusting Christ. Up until the day he died, and I went to his funeral, people were talking about how righteous he was. They were drinking and throwing beer cans in the grave. I told him, what's righteous about getting shot in the back and bumped through the door? Nothing. He was 21 years old. I want my life to count. And your life to count. We got some young people in here. God's going to do some wonderful things for you. It's all up to you. First Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. I will read verse, but it says, you've been bought with a price. The blood of the King of the universe who died in your place. And I'm running out of time. I haven't even got started yet. The past is the past. But remember, we always look to the reality of Christ. Don't let something that's happened in the past stop you from doing what you and the Lord want to do today. He forgives you. Forgive yourself. Let God empower you to go and change the world. Change the world where you're at. And then let Him expand that horizon and make a difference. Back to 1 Timothy, where I actually started, and I got one verse out of that. 1 Timothy 1:13, even though I was formerly a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent aggressor, yet I was shown mercy because I acted ignorantly and in unbelief. There were two schools when Paul was going. He studied under a guy named Gamaliel. And there was another guy, Shammai or something like that. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. Gamaliel is the guy who said, leave the disciples alone. If it's of God, you won't be able to do anything about it. And if it's not the uprising in Christ, then the movement will end on its own. We trust Christ, and He guides us. There's nobody in the world can stop you when Christ calls you to do something. And I believe with all my heart that I am absolutely bulletproof when I'm serving Christ until the day He says for it to be different. Period. He can take care of me. He's got a few things you wouldn't believe. Some of the stupid things I've done on my own. The Pharisees were legalists of their day. That's what Paul is. That's where he came from. They believed that by doing these things, it got them into heaven. Works. That's what the law is all about. By the works of the law shall nobody get into heaven. It was by faith. You go back before the law, Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. It's always been by faith. Y'all understand that? You don't get into heaven by doing anything. You get into heaven by simply trusting what Christ did for you. best thing I can, the best place I can remember. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I'm not like other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. It was a publican, a tax collector. You know who I think that was? I don't know who the Pharisee was, but that was probably Matthew. He was a tax collector. And he couldn't, it says he couldn't even look up. All he could do was be his presence. God had mercy. The Pharisee used himself for the scale that he was figuring for what it would take to get into heaven, and he was perfect. And the publican wasn't like him, so he wasn't going. Because he tithed, because he fasted, because he prayed. You know, the Pharisees would be going into town. They would slow down because a certain time every day they had to pray. So before they got to where they were going, they would slow down and they would catch up where they'd be on the street corner. And they would stand out there and quote these big eloquent prayers, and people would stand around and go, oh, what a wonderful person. And what does the Lord say? They reap their own reward. He said, when you pray, go into your closet. And your Heavenly Father who sees in secret will reward you. I'd rather be rewarded by God any day. Right?
Yes.
Amen. Except for the grace of God. All right. First Timothy 1:15, it's a trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, among whom I am foremost of all. Yet for this reason I found mercy, so that in me as the foremost, Jesus Christ might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example for those who would believe in him for eternal life. We serve because we love Jesus, because of what he's done in us. As simple as that. If you don't have a service for God today, there's nothing going on in your life, ask him where you can be used. He hears. He answers. And let me ask you, do other people see Jesus in you? Lord, thank you for the opportunity to break the word and look at it. Build us up, Lord. Show us where we can serve you best and where we can do the most to hurt, to help the body of believers. We need you in us to guide us. Bless my friends here, meet their needs, and help them continue to grow and serve in new ways for your glory. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Sermon hymn today is on page 500. My faith looks up to thee. Living together in trust, hope, we confess our faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and died in the grave. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We receive our offering. been named here, either aloud or in silence of our hearts.
Adrian Abbasper's son, Felix.
We also lift up all who are affected by the COVID-19 virus. May God's healing presence give them peace and hope in their time of need. For those who have experienced your unconditional love, we thank you, gracious God. God, in your mercy. God of beauty, inspire artists, bless those whose visual and musical gifts enlighten this assembly. Bless the creative work of poets, hymn writers, composers, painters, sculptors, and others that enrich our worship and daily life. God, in your mercy. God of resurrection, bring us to new life. Give us the living bread from heaven through which we abide in your love. And on the last day, raise us with all the saints to eternal life. God, in your mercy. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please stand and we'll sing the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
Holy Spirit, go in peace, serve the Lord and your neighbor.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Don.